Yeah, cause he's intentional. Never failing. I know that all things are working for my good. Yeah, cause he's intentional. Never failing. All things are
working for my good.
Cause he's intentional. Hey, and he's never failing. All things are working for my good. He's intentional.
The morning before the sun even starts to shine, before I open my eyes, you're on my mind. Even if it gets too stormy in here and the winds they start to blow, I can rest assured and know you'll never let me go. You're just when I need you, not a second later. like a superhero.
In the Psalms 107, talks about, give thanks to the Lord for his greatness, goodness, and glorious forever. We need to realize that in times like these, there's opportunity to give thanks to somebody, but particularly God. I always do that now. Before, I didn't always do that because I was on the other side of life. God has transformed my life, and so I'm sharing my testimony a little bit out of that context, if you don't mind. It happened about 1967, thereabouts. I was in the military, U.S. Air Force, serving in Fort Worth, Texas, serving with the B-52 wings. My role was, you call MOS, was AFSC, was security police. I had three particular tasks that I used to serve in the military, but all dealt with security police. We call it AP, like your regular policeman that police the base, security police, like you're doing the flight line, which we're talking about protecting the nuclear weapons and so forth and so on. My testimony starts somewhat in that arena. Vietnam War was very hot at the time. The Da Nang Air Force Base, for those who know anything about it, was the real hot button place. And it was a very terrible time because it was being chopped up, shot up, blown up, and all those things were happening all at one time. There's a young man that used to serve on my group, my flight, when I started out, and his name was John Hall. He was an Anglo man at the time. I can't call him a brother because I wasn't a brother at that time. But he was a good friend. And he had held the gate check, which was to the general command post. So he held that for several years, and all the people who came in on the base at that time with me, who were trained with me, they left to go over to Vietnam or Da Nang, meaning to Thailand or Guam, or one of those areas, heading on their way to Vietnam. There were about five of us left out of all of those troops that were left, talking about 400 people. 500 people, I think, at the time that came in with me. And I was about the fifth one was left. John Hall was taken away. He was sent off to Guam. And so, naturally, what happened was I started the rank is a little bit more senior. I was second airman, second class. And so they gave me the position of the general command post. And I asked my sergeant, staff sergeant, who was now a commissioned officer, you know, what are the responsibilities of this position? Because it's a very powerful position, very important position. He told me what my instruction was, and one of the things, I need to put this a little bit in there because you need to know something. During that time, there was a lot of problems with racial problems. Racism was a very bad thing in the military. And we just had gone through some real serious trouble. So a group of my airmen, myself, got together and said, whatever we do, what we need to do as African Americans is to make our name proud or be responsible people. And we decided to group ourselves together and study all the material that was given to us so that we could know it as best we can, almost perfect to the T at which the military wanted. Saying that to you, we became part of a 95 percentile club, knowing that we knew our stuff practically as well as the technical stuff. Along that time, this position opened up, which was the gate guard for the general. And so they said they needed someone, and so I asked what my role was. When they told me, I said, well, who's the highest person on the base that I need to report to? And they said, the general, of course, is a four-star general. I said, okay, and next to him is the president of the United States. I said, wonderful. I said, what if they come up to my gate shack and do not give me the code or give me their badge? They said, well, you have to stop them because they could be under duress. Duress meaning that someone could be an enemy in the car. Having to understand that, so you have to arrest them or stop them and detain them, and they must show you this badge. Why, Satan? Long story short, after about 8 months on the duty, Before then, let's go back. I spoke to the general. I spoke to the general because in order to be his gate guard, he had to interview you. So I said to him, sir, who's the highest person on this base that I should respect and give authority to? He said, I am the highest person, I have to be the president. I said, what if you come up to my gate at one day and then you don't give me the code or you don't show me your badge? He said, arrest me. I said, okay. 8 months later, we had what's called Second Air Force, the highest Air Force command at that time. They came in and do similarly bombing the planes. Came in through the gate shack. I was on duty that day. And so they came in and they simulated bomb all the planes. These are nuclear planes. They are loaded and ready to go at a moment's notice. That's why it was so important, that position. Well, they started taking the stripes off the sergeants and the airmen, and they busted them down and they moved them out. And then that next day, it was my duty to be on post. And so when I came on post, it was a very busy day, very busy time. And while the business came, the general came, an alert happened. And the general, it's a SAC base, by the way, it's a SAC 24-hour alert base. The general came up with this, with a crew of people in this car. I recognized the car. That's one of the things that we must be able to do, recognize the general's car. I recognized the general. That's the second thing, the most important thing you need to do. But he had other people in the car I did not recognize. I did recognize one person in the car, but that doesn't matter. The fact that they're having an alert, and all the planes are about ready to fly at moment's notice. The general came up and he said to me, Captain, drop the rope, right now, let me through the gate. And I saw the people in the car, I saluted the car, I walked with them, I said, sir, can I have your badge? He said, no, you can't. He said, let me in. He said, don't you know we have an alert? I said, yes, sir, I see that we have an alert, but I need to have, give me the code. He said, no, you can't have the code. So I snapped my weapon out. And Texas is 110 degrees in the sun. Yeah. And I told him, get on the ground. I blew my whistle, and the machine guns were sighted around his vehicle. And so I was arresting the general at his command post. I was a lowly two-stripe soldier, arresting the general and all the people in his car. Just as they were about to get out the car, there was this passenger in the back seat who was also a four-star general, but he was an attached wing commander of F-111. And he didn't want to lay on the hot ground real quickly, so he said, Catchings, before you do that, he said, here's my badge. And he said, I'll give you the code. But now that I have this badge, the valid badge, and the code, I said to him, the general was the driver of the car, he was a backseat driver. I said to him, the general in the back, I said, sir, looking at your badge and your code that you give me, do you boss for everybody in the member of the party in this car? He said, yes, Sergeant Ketchum, I do. I said, then here's your badge. And general, you may proceed on your vouching for everybody in the car. Now it gets very sticky from here because, you see, the general who was driving the car is the base commander. It's his base. It's his gate shack. I am his guard, peon as I was, and I arrested him. He flew up the gate, and I opened the gate, he flew up and ran inside his office. He called up my commanding officer, at that time was a major. He cursed me every word and invented words that he could not find in the dictionary and called me all these names because I arrested the general at his post. All my friends, all the troops that I trained, they asked me, why did you do this crazy captain? They called me crazy captain, okay? They said, didn't you not recognize him? Why did you let him go? I said, because he didn't give me the code, neither did he give me his badge. They said, oh, you know who he was, you see him every day. I said, yes, all that is true, but we had an alert. And I didn't know the people in the car, so I arrested him. They said, oh, you're crazy. So they sent a chief master sergeant from my major's office to relieve me of my duty.
Oh,
they
wow.
Said, stand up and get captured because now you have embarrassed the base, you have embarrassed the general, and you are relieved of your duty. They took away my weapons from me. They put me under house arrest. They told me what was happening to me was that I had earned my vacation to Southeast Asia. They said, you wanted a southern vacation? You're getting one to Southeast Asia. They're pushing your borders through to go to Vietnam during the Tet Offense. They had planned to send me overseas to get rid of their embarrassment. It took them 2 weeks to try to get my orders through because of the system. But I believe God had a plan.
Thank you.
Amen.
John Hall, for months, was talking to me about the gospel of Jesus Christ while I ate apple pie with him at that Hitch Chat. And I tried to argue, like the jailhouse prisoners try to argue about a lawyer about being God, they know about God. So I would argue with him about this God that he was talking about. And I didn't know all the time God was working on me, okay? And so, long story short, that part, they arrested me for 2 weeks. They put me in, I had a guard. Each time I went to the mess hall to eat, there was two guards on both sides of me. I could not go to the mess hall or eat anything unless a guard on both sides of me. One day, when I think my orders was about coming through, that's the way people are telling me. I hear from people who are telling me that your orders is about coming through. My major called me into the office. He sent two big strapping soldiers, sergeants of arms, but they're huge guys. And they came to me and they said, come on, Major wants to see you right now, Captain. Get dressed and come right away. So I got dressed and went down to his office. This man who cursed me out, invented words to talk about me, tell me who I am and how I derelict my duty, he's now smoking a cigar with a smile on his face. And he's talking to me like he's my daddy. Hello. Hey, Captains, come on in, have a seat. Sat down, I'm looking around at everybody and I'm speaking to their eyes because at this point, if I'm going to Vietnam to Da Nang Air Force Base, I don't have no time. Don't mess with me, okay? Just tell me what you want me to do and let me go. So he said, no. He said, sit down. So I'm sitting there looking around at all these guys and they have big eyes feasted on me. Lieutenants and all those, they got their eyes feasted on me. So I said, nothing. So he said, Ketchum, do you know what's happening on our base? I said, sir, what does this have to do with me? He said, well, Ketchum, he said, you know, we bust the sergeants and, you know, we have to put lieutenants out there. We're going to have to catch these people. I said, sir, what does this have to do with me? I'm really mad, okay? So then he said to me in a nice voice, he said, well, if you go out on your post and if you catch them, they'll give you a 3-day pass. 3-day pass. I'm under house arrest. You better go to Vietnam. And you're going to play with my mind and tell me you're going to give me a 3-day pass? So I said to him, and? He said, and? I said, and? He said, okay, we'll give you weekends off because we work around the clock. Okay? Mm-hmm. I said, 3-day pass, and we put and off. He said, and he was smiling and sitting down and all the guys looking at him. I said, man, what is general, what's Major giving away? I said, 3-day pass, and you know. I said, and? He said, and? This time he started to turn red. And so I looked at him, I said, and? And he said, we'll give you normal hours. We'll normalize your hours, you'll have regular working hours. You come on at 8 o'clock, 3-day pass, and weekend off. I said, and? This time he started to stand up a little bit because he's trying to figure out what in the world is going on. The sergeant started to come closer to me and flex their muscles, you know? And I just look at them like, you know, you guys are crazier than I am. So he said, and? He said, okay, we'll give you all of that. We'll give you promotion in order. Promotion. Yes, we'll promote you as well. I said, this time I waited a few seconds. I said, and? And at this point, all the sergeants and all the people in the office started moving closer to me, and I just didn't look at all of them. Because if I'm going to Vietnam, I don't care what you say to me. If I'm going to die, then let me die in my way, not your way, okay? Mm-hmm. So he said, and, he said, and. I said, he said, we'll give promotion to the Lord. I said, and. He said, what? I said, I want you to write it, sir, that I was arrested for doing my duty. And I'll take everything that you said. I will receive all of those gifts that you said, but you must have it written that I was arrested for doing my duty. He said, Ketchum, everything you asked was that I said, I will do. Can you come start tomorrow? Tomorrow morning, he wants me to start this duty. So I asked him, I said, am I free right now to walk around the base without guards? He said, yes. So the first place I did, I went to the mess hall. I went to the mess hall without guards. And they started to call on the phone to see whether I had escaped. That's what it was, because I didn't have guards, right? Well, here's fast forward. The next day is my duty. I started my duty at 8 o'clock in the morning. The first thing that happened to me was that the general cook came out of the office and he brought me about a stack of pies. I had 10 pies, afternoon or whatever. About noon time, another alert happened. All these things are going on. Then the vehicle came up, but people who recognized me and I recognized them. And so what they did was, this was the vehicle, I didn't know. This was the vehicle that had all of the people who were going to be able to assimilate bombing the plane. So I snatched the first badge off the first guy and I said, good morning, sir, how are you doing? And while the other one is talking, I snatched his badge off. I never looked at any one of them. I walked around the side of the statue. He said, Ketchup, we got to get inside this place. You know, we have an alert. And I said, yes, this won't take long. I went to the back door of the little place where they have maintenance thing, and I knocked on the door. Normally, it's supposed to be equipment in there. Someone opened the door and said, hi, Ketchup. I snatched his badge. Okay. So when I got his badge, I turned around and looked on it. It was a bogus badge. This, I tell you the story, that the Lord allowed me to catch the whole team in one shot. On duty. Why am I saving the time to tell you this? Because if I was not on that base, if all these events didn't happen to me, then I would not be there for the next event that took place in my life. God sent some teenagers that following day or so to knock on my door to give me a message saying that it was a message for me. God saved my soul because I was about to go out and celebrate in Texas with all the rest of the airmen in a place where I shouldn't be. And so I was arrested. I was not arrested, but I was arrested by the Holy Spirit on that last time. And so I'm here to tell you this is what my story is about Vietnam. That's just a part of it. But since I have to stop here, I just give you that. God bless you.